On this episode of the John 1911 podcast, the Wolf A1 uppers hit the U.S., another terrorist attack in Paris, an African PH eaten by crocodiles, and the Delisle debate continues.
Okay, good morning, everybody. This is Marky and Freeze, and this is episode 60 of the John 1911 podcast. How's it going, Freeze?
Oh, man, it's going good. I'm slap happy and overly caffeinated, and that's always a good thing.
Dude, we were sitting here bullcrap. And go ahead, tell me the meme. I should wish I just record. Tell me the meme you saw.
I saw a meme the other day. It had a picture of a trampoline on it, and the words were, "They used to be called jumpalines until your mom jumped on one back in 1972. Jumpalines. Oh, damn, that's funny.
God bless. The internet is always good for a laugh.
Oh, yeah. On our last podcast, we talked about the United airline incident where the guy got drug off the plane after a beatdown.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I saw another meme. It had a picture of a United airline aircraft, and it was destroyed. I don't know if it was a parts plane or whatever, but it was a mess. And the caption was, United Airlines employees tried to remove Chuck Norris. And you know, Chuck Norris jokes never get old.
They never get old. He seems like a really decent guy.
You know, I don't know who started the whole Chuck Norris is bigger than God type thing, but whoever did that was like a genius. Because, you know, the whole Chuck Norris things, they're hilarious.
They're pretty funny. They're definitely pretty funny. So.
Oh, yeah.
Speaking of, we never really talked about the airline thing. I mean, you know, it's not really kind of in our lane, but I mean, you know, now everyone's piling on. Like, there was a story the other day, United kicked off, I think it was a newlywed couple that was flying either to their wedding or to their honeymoon.
I heard about that story.
And it's like, you know, I mean, I don't really have that much of an opinion on United Airlines, but I think it's pretty safe to say that the CEO of that company will not be around for long. His career window is closing.
Yeah. Well, look, I mean, at the end of the day, and I've had this discussion with several people, especially some of my my snowflake liberal friends. You know, they all want to, you know, after the incident, they all want to, you know, demonize United and, you know, and prop this little Chinese fucker up for, you know, is their, you know, hero of the day. And I told him, I said, first off, you got two issues. I said, first off, let me clarify. I don't agree with United's policy of overselling seats, you know, but it is what it is. And all airlines do it. I said, but on the other hand, and we talk about this all the time, you know, don't be a jackass because you're always being recorded, you know. Now, this doctor, this Chinese, you know, Oriental, Korean, Vietnamese, I don't know what the hell he is.
He's of Chinese descent and went to medical school in Vietnam.
He's a dirtbag. The guy is a bona fide grade A scumbag.
You know what? See, I am so glad you brought that up because that's the real meat of the story for our listeners.
Well, yeah, it is because here's the thing. Okay, it doesn't matter if it's United, Delta, whatever, JetBlue, it doesn't matter. If they ask you that, you know, if they tell you to deplane because you have to get off the plane, there's only going to be one recourse. And that's you leaving the plane. No matter how much you cry, bitch, whine, or fight, you are leaving that plane. That's the bottom line end of the day. You're not going to argue them into saying, well, you know what, you're right. No, you have to leave. Now, you can do it two ways. You can do it civilly and leave the plane and file your complaints and then get 10,000 sky miles or whatever the hell they're going to give you. Or you can choose to fight and they'll beat you down and drag you off like they did this guy. And I'm talking to these snowflake friends of mine. And, you know, and I'm telling them this, and it's like, look, I don't agree with United's policy, and I don't necessarily agree that the guy deserved the beatdown. But at the end of the day, if you watch the video, because several people recorded it with their phones, the guy was screaming like a three-year-old child at the top of his lungs, refused to leave, and he escalated it to the point where they beat this guy down and drug him off the plane. Now, that's his fault, because he could have walked off that plane like a man and then filed his complaint and did what he had to do. He chose to be drug off like a child because that's the way he acted. But that's not surprising, because the guy's a scumbag. This guy lost his license because he was, like, pimping, getting...
He's a pill mill doctor.
Yeah, well, what he was doing is he was writing prescriptions for controlled drugs to a guy, trying to get him addicted so he could he could trade prescriptions for gay sex. The guy's a dirt fucking bag.
Let's back up from this a little bit and look at it from like a higher altitude of like 10,000 feet. Let me use an airline analogy here. This is where our listeners really should pay attention to this. Look, in today's world, all right, you can be as right as rain, okay? Your position can be solid. You didn't do anything wrong. But what's going to happen is your entire resume or universe or history is going to, first of all, whatever you engage in is going to be recorded, and then everybody's going to, quote, dox you. That's what they call it, doxing, D-O-X. And they're going to go through all of your background and all of this stuff, and they can destroy you. And it's a perfect example of this guy. It's probably a reflection of – I'll say it the way you're saying it, but a different way. It's probably a reflection of his character that this degenerated into a big fight. On the plane. Now, to the United issue itself, what United, look, I don't know the economic reasons as to why they choose to oversell and then yank people off to shuttle their flight crews around. It's obviously to save money, but if they should have a practice of basically, you know, letting the economics, if you have to oversell, we're okay. We need to get some people off the plane. We'll give you $200 and this, $300, $400, $500. You know, we need more. We need one more. And if you're up to like $5,000 and first class and X, Y, or Z, you just have to do it to where finally somebody's like, I'm going to get off the plane. And if that becomes too expensive, stop overselling your goddamn seats. Now, Let me, as for the issues of the dirtbag doctor, because you brought it up, and this is an example of doxing, okay? This guy, you know, he's got a checkered history, a checkered past, which is fine.
It also tells what kind of his character is.
Well, here's the thing. A newspaper in the United Kingdom, and this is always true. Whenever there's a major story, if you want more photographs and more information, go to a UK paper. Don't go to the US media, because everything's sanitized. Go to the UK papers, and they'll give you full pictures. They track stuff down, and they had sent somebody outside this man's house in Kentucky and took a photograph of his house, and it was published in a UK paper. You know, I mean, it's just an example of you're always going to be on camera, and you need to, you know, instead of like getting into a fight with a bunch of people, you know, that could very easily be like, you know, you carrying a gun and you're saying things on film in a self-defense situation that you now have a hard time justifying in court. But let me go ahead and add one more element to this conversation that I think needs to be said. And this is in regards to law enforcement in this individual case. Now, I don't know what department that was that yanked him off that plane. I don't know if it was a Chicago PD. I don't know if it was an airport PD, or if it's, is that airport like technically in somebody else's small little town? So that small little PD, basically runs that airport. But there used to be a time before the lawyers and cameras and the world opinion was involved in every decision that a cop used to be like, why am I here? Well, we oversold the seats and we need to get people off and we need volunteers. This guy, he's being disruptive. We're pulling him off the plane and he doesn't want to get off the plane. So you got to get him off the plane. And the cop can go, used to be a time when a cop would do this. He or she would go, did he buy a ticket? Yes. Not my problem. Why are you calling me? You solve this problem. You know, this is where that's a failure here. Sometimes police departments need to be able to say no. Now, I realize, and our listeners, a lot of our listeners may not understand this, but, you know, when you're dealing with aircraft and airplanes and all this, it's a different situation because the threshold for disturbing the peace or being disruptive is a lot lower in airports and jetways and on aircraft, because once that airplane's up at 30,000 feet, you can't kick people off airplanes. So, you know, it's a little bit more serious in that situation than it is on the ground, but it's still the logic holds true. At some point, a police department needs to be like, you know, why the fuck are you calling me to kick somebody off a plane that has a full fare ticket? Not my problem.
Well,
have a nice day.
I totally agree with you, but the way it has become kind of a standard, and I mean, the only way to stop the standard is to, fly a different airline. I don't know, hurt them in the pocketbook.
Well, you know, everybody's got a big come to Jesus moment as far as, you know, I didn't know how bad this overselling happened or what was going on. You know, I mean, I've been on flights before. I fly a lot. I've been on flights before where they're like, you know, we need people. We'll offer you this, you know, and it goes on for like 15 minutes. We need one more person, you know, and I remember there was one time I was like, you know what? I'll take that deal. But the situation, it wouldn't have been, it probably wouldn't have been optimal. And I was seriously thinking about taking it. And somebody else finally stepped, because they used market economics to basically entice enough people to give up seats. It was probably for a flight crew, which now I realize is what it was. But what needs to happen here is there needs to be a change in the culture of law enforcement, especially in this country and maybe in like this airport or airports, but not every problem needs to be 911's problem. And see, that's where I think this airport, and this is where this gets kind of shitty, you know. This degenerates into an argument when it shouldn't have. They should have basically just stroked him a big-ass check to get him off the plane. We'll make it worth your while. Or the guy next to him's like, man, you're going to give him $10,000 and 100,000 sky miles and whatever, whatever. All right, I'll get off. And, you know, handled it like that. But instead, everybody wants to dick check each other. They're going to call the cops. So now when you call the cops at an airport, I mean, it's like a train going down the tracks. It X 1, 2, 3, or 4 is happening. You're not going to, the cops aren't going to go away. But here's the thing. It used to be that, you know, smart policing would show up, investigate, and be like, so what's going on here? Well, this is this situation. This is this person. This is the problem we're having. And the police officer could go, doesn't sound like a law enforcement problem to me at all. You guys fork it out amongst yourselves. Don't make me come back here. Or somebody's going to jail, and it may not be who you think. Have a nice day. That's what's not being discussed here.
Well, I mean, you're right. But on the other hand, again, let's go back to, you know, how you handle the situation. Look, overselling tickets and offering people compensation to get off of the flight is not new. I guarantee you they offered this guy some kind of compensation.
They did, but they didn't. They actually said what the numbers were. And the thing is, they should have just kept publicly announcing. See, what it was is they went up to a certain number where then they were like, there must be some scale. There must be some document that says you're allowed to offer up to this. And you're not allowed to offer.
Sure they're.
Yeah. And then after that, there's no more. And so they literally went through like freaking, you know, like freaking Auschwitz and picking people out for the fucking gas chamber. And, you know, that's the problem. And so they figured they could just, you know, okay, we're only going to go up to a certain point economically to where it's not too painful. And then we're just going to go ahead and fuck somebody over randomly. And that's where I have a big problem with that. If they had just basically turned the money up and up and up and up and it got high enough, all of a sudden people were like, you're going to do what for me? I'm fucking out of here, dude. I'll go sit in the bar for 3 hours. And I can fly first class every day for the next 6 months. And then, you know, if United doesn't want to, you know, if they're looking at the numbers and they don't like those economics, maybe they could make a change to their booking system so maybe they can lower their costs on the front end so this doesn't happen. This is where the businesses decide they don't like the economics, and so they decide to short circuit the market and call the cops to solve their economic problem. And I have a big problem with that. And I have a big problem with that police department, whoever's the police chief of that department. And I know you're dealing into some federal stuff with an airport as well. But, you know, cops need to be able to go, not my fucking problem, dude. If the cop had shown up and basically was like, what's going on? This, okay. Doesn't sound like my problem. That could have, I don't know, because this guy's, you know, a raging asshole. That could have diffused it enough to where maybe the airline's like, well, okay, we're going to have to offer more money. You know, and everybody, none of this would have made the papers.
Well, you know, like I was saying, I mean, you know, this stuff happens all the time, probably every day. This guy chose to be, you know, he chose to go over the top. You know, I understand he didn't want to leave the flight. And maybe the compensation they were offering him wasn't enough. But at the end of the day, he chose to take the route he chose. You know, I mean, watch the video. I mean, he's screaming at the top of his lungs. They try to grab him. He's like fighting with them, slapping on them, you know, and it escalated.
He gave them, he gave them his money and he has a ticket and a seat. And I understand going in, I mean, I got a ticket. I got a seat. I'm checked in. I'm gold. I'm in. There's nothing, you know, I made my flight. I'm here. I'm checked in. I've got a seat number. I'm done. It's mine. I have never seen them just yank a seat from somebody like that arbitrarily. I fly all the goddamn. I've never seen them actually kick somebody off a plane like that for a fucking flight. I've never seen that. And I tell you what, mentally, in America, where people pay money and, you know, I give you money, that's my seat. No, I gave you money. I could very easily see a lot of reasonable people that aren't fucking gay pedophile goddamn dope pill doctors throwing down on some motherfuckers when the dude is on the plane. His luggage is in the belly.
Yeah.
I venture to guess a lot more people would throw down on that. And I'm, you know, United.
Well, and you know what? At the end of the day, you can throw down on it all you want, but the end result will be you will be beat down and drug off the plane.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. You're not going to win.
I mean, that's the bottom line.
Yeah,
you're not going to win.
You're not going to win. But, you know, I mean, I didn't start this conversation even thinking I'm going to take the doctor's side, because I'm not taking the doctor's side, because this is when assholes collide. And look, you and I both know. Look, let's be real here. Here's what's not being reported. And you and I, we know this dude. We know that this guy is a jackass, and he was probably acting like a jackass during this entire process, that basically made them single him out because he's making snide comments or insulting people or insulting the airline or insulting the goddamn, you know, flight crew, you know, during this whole process. And they decide, oh, you're volunteering. You know that's true. You know that's probably true.
Sure.
He probably brought the light onto himself and, quote, volunteered through his bad attitude. And that,
sure.
You know, that's there's a good lesson there for people, especially for our market, for people that listen to us.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
You know what? This is a segue, and I'm going to bring this up because, dude, I love this story. And this is an example of how, like, the British papers will cover news better than American papers. Have you ever – and this is how shit comes out and becomes a national news. Have you ever heard of Coastal Carolina University in Myrtle Beach?
No.
I don't know what division school they are.
What is it, like a subsect of like Phoenix International, or is it a real institution?
It's well. I mean, they have a cheerleading squad, so I'm pretty sure that they. I mean, they've got a football team. You know what I mean? They've got sports. I mean, so it's a campus.
Okay.
Let's see. I'm trying to find the best way to read this. The entire cheerleading team is suspended, but Coastal Carolina University isn't talking. So the entire, you know, so your local school, you know, whatever, you know, institution of liberal indoctrination, all of a sudden the 5 o'clock news says local Carolina University has suspended their entire cheerleading team. No further details are forthcoming. And it's like... What's going on there? So
okay, talk about throwing one out there. It's like, holy shit, you're going to tell me they're suspended, but not why.
Yeah, the entire team. Well, apparently the team is made up of 15 to 18, I think, members. And I don't know if they've got guys on this team. But long story short, it looks like a bunch of these girls were turning tricks at some escort companies that were probably servicing the Myrtle Beach Hotel area, which is a lot. The Myrtle Beach escort scene is a pretty thriving scene. These girls were working, I'm assuming girls.
Maybe it was girls and guys. It was the whole team.
Did you just assume the gender of my hooker?
it depends. I mean, it depends on how you roll.
Well, somebody wrote a letter. They didn't get caught. They weren't detected by law enforcement. They weren't detected by a news outlet. Somebody wrote a letter to the school saying that that members of the team were going on dates on an escort service ranging in price from $150 to $1,500 a date.
Damn, $1,500 a date? Holy crap.
$1,500 escorts are typically like bigger city escorts like New York, and I should stop talking now, shouldn't I?
Well, a $1,500 escort, I mean, she's got to be, she's got to like do like special tricks.
A $1,500 escort is not as much money as it used to be. But some of these girls, like, still $1,500 in Myrtle Beach is a lot of money. And
But I'm a cheap bastard. So if I'm going to pay $1,500, I mean, you got to like stand on your head and spin and do all kinds of crazy shit.
Because
I work in the neighborhood where a cheeseburger will buy you a hoe.
That's actually true.
Yeah, that's actually true. So
that girl died, right? That one hooker.
Yeah, she OD'd, and no one was around to Narcan her ass back to life. But look, I mean, so like I said, $1,500. I mean, you know, that's high living for my neighborhood.
See, if we were still making shirts, it would be like I'm not a hooker, but $1,500 is $1,500.
Hey, for $1,500, you'd be surprised what I would do.
So, well, but the backup here, to be fair, I haven't followed this story's a few weeks old, and, you know, we don't really cover this kind of stuff, but I kept it in, you know, in my pocket in case, you know, if something funny, but, for all we know, it could have all been, you know, resolved and adjudicated. None of it's even true. I mean, it could be that I need to say this. Maybe this entire thing was like a fake news, you know, whatever. But I mean, the thing is, this was picked up by the Myrtle Beach Online website, and then it was picked up by one of the, you know, the Daily Mail or one of the typical, you know, typical grags in the UK. So, you know, it's they run them up. So, you know, but it's an example of how you don't realize that you would do or say or engage in activity, whereas 10 years ago, 15 years ago, it may make the paper. Now it's international news. You know, and everybody's going to go deep dive into your shit and question not just your decision, whether it was right or wrong, but they're going to question your character for your entire life up to that moment to decide whether you were even justified in either being in that situation or making that decision or using that to maybe move the goalpost on you a little bit, where a normal person, that would have been a quote justified shooting or justified behavior. But since you're a lifelong dirtbag pillhead doctor, you know, it's not even justified. Maybe it's just something where it's just they're using it as you're not a sympathetic person now, this character assassination. So, you know, it's just one of those things. So what the hell happened last night in Paris? Was there a terrorist attack?
Yeah, there was. A couple of French police were killed. And I mean, I've seen multiple headlines on it, but I'll be honest with you. I was working last night and I was busy and I really haven't had a chance to read any of the details. I don't know any details to it. I know Trump actually commented on it this morning. I haven't listened to the video or watched or read any transcripts. I know nothing about it other than the fact that, from what I understand, just from headlines, it was apparently an ISIS-related attack and one or more French police officers were killed in Paris. That's all I know.
So, I mean, I hate to say it like this, but it's not a mass casualty attack. It's a shooting or something on the Champs-Élysées?
From what I understand. But again, I could be wrong on that. I don't know. Like I said, I've just been, you know, I worked last night. I got off, had to do a bunch of crap. And then, you know, then we started this. So I haven't really had time to delve into any details.
See, the reason I'm interested in this topic is I'm watching the French election very closely because of what happened in the American election. Look, our regulars know that I went to bed the night of the election because I was like, you know, Trump's not going to win. Because, you know, I mean, even you and everybody's like, Trump's got to win. You know, he's got to win, what was it, North Carolina, he's got to win Virginia, he's got to win Pennsylvania, he's got to win Ohio. And it was like, as soon as I heard Pennsylvania, I'm like, get the fuck out of here. You know, that's where Republicans go to die. Well, here's the thing. In France, Marie Le Pen is their quote right wing, is their conservative candidate. And Le Pen, the party's called Le Pen too because it was started by her father. For our American listeners, I would describe Marie Le Pen similarly to the Paul family, like Rand and Ron Paul that we've talked about. She's the prodigal daughter of the original father. And so, you know, France is France, and you know, there's never, you know, I mean, you know, I mean, it's like, yeah, whatever, Le Pen, whatever, yeah, they're sure they're gonna win. Well, she's apparently a front runner, and there she's gonna make, because they do different rounds. They do, you know, first round ballot winning, and then they do a runoff between the top two if no one gets above 50%, maybe, or I'm not sure exactly how it works in France, but she's apparently, they're predicting she's going to definitely make it to the runoff. And the fact that a right-wing candidate like her is going to could make it that far in France, and there's now more terrorist attacks going on in France. This hype, this theoretical argument that, that Europe is going to swing right to try to, you know, repair the damage that Angela Merkel has done to that continent. This could happen in France, and I'm like, I mean, if it could happen, if Donald Trump can win in America, as crazy as it sounds to me, Marie Le Pen could win in France, and that's extremely interesting.
Well,
so that, you know, that's why I'm, you know, I mean, it's like, I mean, dude, the the picture that I'm looking at, that, I mean, that is the, I mean, it's like this shooting happened right in front of the Arc de Triomphe. I mean, it's, you know, the, yeah, you know, the famous photograph or the video when the German army's marching down the big street and the people are standing, you know, the French people are standing, you know, they're crying.
Yeah.
That's the road this happened. That's a big, that's a, it's a huge road, first of all, mm-hmm. and it's kind of a big deal. And I mean, it's just, I just, I'm curious what people that are like you and me that live in real France, you know, now don't live in Paris, just think about all this bullshit. I just wonder if she's going to win.
Okay. A witness told Sky News that a guy came out with a Kalashnikov and started shooting.
What? A Kalashnikov in France? Yeah.
That's what the that's what a witness is
fake
saying.
Fake news, fake news.
Says the gunman was apparently known to authorities and was previously flagged as an extremist.
Okay, you know what? I'm going to stop you right there. And you know what? This, I've never mentioned this, but this really pisses me off. This whole, well, this person was on a terror watch list, or this person was previously known to authorities, or this, or this, or this. You always hear that bullshit, and it's like, oh, okay, so it's fine. You know, like, you know, some guy, you know, basically, you know, nukes a mall in America. Oh, yeah, the guy was on a watch list. We knew about him. He didn't get by us.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, apparently he did get by you.
You know? Yeah, it's just, I hate that.
Yeah. But apparently two cops are dead and the gunman's been killed. And they're suspecting ISIS, you know, collusion or whatever. So.
See, in France, a lot of the cops walk around in little packs. Like there's a, especially in Paris, I mean, in France, I should say in Paris, a lot of the police walk around on foot and they travel. Like you'll even see police walking in like groups of four and five. And, it would be nothing to just see police officers walking a beat and maybe just, I guess maybe this guy saw some cops walking and went after him. Somebody shot up a former FBI field office in Eastern Russia, I guess last night, this morning too.
Yeah.
FSB office, which is, you know, out near, you know, like it's like out in like the Siberian region. You know, we talked about last time on Facebook that, you know, the Russians have been moving troops from around Vladivostok, you know, with their 11-mile border with Korea,
mm-hmm.
North Korea. And, you know, somebody went in and shot up this office. And they're reporting that the guy who shot up the office is apparently not a Muslim, but maybe a Nazi or something. So, or like a Nazi, I guess, I don't know, like what the Russian version of Timothy McVeigh, maybe. I mean, I don't know what that is exactly, but you know, hey, on gun news, there's a report coming out. I guess the German army has decided, the Bundeswehr has decided that they are going to, they've started the process of replacing the G36 rifles with that H&K gun that looks like a copy of like the Remington ACR rifle.
Yeah, I heard something about that a couple weeks ago.
Well, yeah, the Remington AC, that or that H&K rifle, we talked about it, but I guess now there's a move that they are, because there's issues with, I don't know if you recall, Freeze, there's issues with the G36 supposedly having accuracy problems and the gun heats up, especially in hot climates, because the trunnion sits in plastic. And they're basically, it looks like this may be for real. They may actually, the German army is going to basically switch to a pseudo kind of I wouldn't call this an M. I don't know, dude. I probably would call this an AR rifle. I mean, it's a piston AR.
Yeah.
To me, it's a piston AR with a charging handle that doesn't reciprocate. It's got it's got a side charging handle up front, kind of like the So, you know, that's interesting. I'm just, you know, I wonder if H&K is building a facility in the U.S. I wonder if H&K would ever cut up G36s, bring them in the U.S., then rebuild them and sell them as surplus.
That's a possibility. I mean, we'd be talking several years down the road. But
I don't know if it would be several, but I mean, I know that. I mean, dude, that would decimate some. Like, there's a couple, like Tommy Built Tactical and a couple other shops that do custom G36 conversions based off of, some older H&K guns. But I tell you what, the American market, the collector market would just, dude, they would sop up every G36 that you could get into this country. A real one?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, look, if they cut them up and brought them in as parts kits, you know, Century would be all over that. And they would, of course, they'd do the same thing they did with, like, the VZ-58. They'd convert them and just start selling G36s.
Well, H&K is building a factory down by Fort Stewart, Georgia. An actual domestic production facility, or they're expanding it. And so there's talk that, you know, why are they doing that? Are they going to try to, you know, that's one of the things that holds them back on some RFPs, is because, you know, they have domestic production of a gun of certain equipment. And, you know, I mean, if I would be curious, they, I don't know. I'm of two minds of this. On one, you know, they're doing that to try to get business either in the American market or with the American government. And they're not going to give up a chance at getting business with the American government by giving up capacity to possibly placate the American commercial market. So I just don't know. You could be right. It may be many years. But it would be, dude, they would sell every freaking G36 actually made by H&K. Bring in the uppers.
I mean, look, here's the thing. If they brought in G36 parts kits, people would buy them up, and then it'd be kind of like the
What I'm saying is H&K would literally bring in, they would basically destroy the receivers in Germany, bring the rest of the parts kits into their facility in Georgia, make American receivers, and then sell them as H&K guns.
Yeah, maybe.
What's the receiver on a G36, the upper or the lower? I don't know. I don't think I've ever fired a G36.
I believe it's the lower.
Are we sure? Because, like, the SCAR, it's the upper. The SIG 556 XI guns that you like, is it the upper or the lower that's their serialized part?
It's the upper.
Okay, so, I mean, I don't know. I don't know. That would be interesting. Oh, you know what? Actually, Fort Stewart, dude, I want to send you a picture. Dude, I gotta send this to you. Hold on. Are you by your there's a story that came out yesterday. They busted a drug ring. Where is it at? Here we go. They busted a drug ring. I think it's at Fort Stewart, which is where the H&K's putting their, like, the Ranger regiment's down there. So I want to send you this photograph. This is the photograph. So that, you know, CID was involved, the local drug unit, the sheriff's involved. They arrested a couple people. And they also ended up doing a lockdown on the base, and they they're searching because there's, you know, a bunch of I'm not going to say enlisted because who knows, but a bunch of soldiers involved in this drug ring. There is a photograph of this one guy. I'm sending this to you right now. This is how this dude got caught. Check your email. This photograph of this guy, he's in his uniform with his name tag, with a pile of cocaine, a stack of money, and coke all over his nose. And it's sitting, it looks like a little school desk. and you got to see this picture, dude. You have
it. I just got it.
I mean, it's
dude,
like,
that's awesome.
I mean, it's like, seriously? I mean,
sweet.
I mean, dude, criminals are not smart, dude. And we'll probably have to put this picture up on the blog page. Dude, tell me, this is where we do bad as a podcast. If people could see this photograph, it's like, I mean, it's, look, part of me is like, it's sad and it's, you know, that's just terrible. But on the other end, it's like, dude, if you're going to go out, you might as well go out in a blaze of glory. This is like Tony Montoya, Scarface, crazy, stupid bullshit, this kid.
Yeah.
This is awesome. I mean, it's,
it is,
I mean,
awesome.
Yeah. It's, I mean, it's like, I mean, this kid looks like, are those 20s or 100s, Freeze? I haven't been around the dope game in a while. How much money? He's got money on his lap and he's got money in his hand. I mean, is that what, $40,000 in cash?
Oh man, if those are 20s, let's just say they're 20s, the stack he's got in his hand, oh God, I don't know, 10 grand, easy.
So if that's 10 grand, he's got another 10, 20, at least 30 grand in his lap, if not 40 grand.
Oh, he might have $40,000 or $50,000 in that picture, not counting the value of the coke.
Yeah,
and the fact that he was like eating it like Cheerios. If you look at his mouth and chin and nose.
Yeah, so they're busy down at Fort Stewart today.
Good for them. Oh, by the way, the receiver on a G36 is the lower.
Cool. Because that's in, I would think that would be the easiest part to make.
Oh, yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Dude, I'd buy one of those all goddamn day. Like, you know, I mean, look, would I buy the, like, the tactical one, or would I buy one that's like a representative gun, like with the full charging handle over the top?
Well, you know, here's the thing. If they bring in G36 parts kits that are cut up, you just buy whatever.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I'm anticipating H&K. I don't anticipate them coming, the parts kits coming to the U.S. market and being sold to the public. I would guess H&K would just go ahead and bring them into the U.S. and do what they have to do.
Who knows? You know, who knows? We'll see. But it's interesting and exciting news because, I mean, regardless of whether they bring in parts kits and sell them as parts kits because someone will make a semi-lower, or whether Century brings them in and builds semi-auto G36s and sells them the way they did the VZs, or whether HK brings them in and then rebuilds them and sells them. It, regardless of the scenario, it's exciting. I'm interested.
Yeah. Let me ask you this. You know, AIM had gotten in a bunch of those Wolf A1 uppers that everybody's on the internet talking about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Are you interested in those?
I'm very interested in them. They're piston uppers. And I don't know. What do we have? We have at least one, if not two, lowers floating around the armory, don't we?
Yeah. I mean, we've got – we got an LWRC lower. I didn't even think about that. That's basically sitting on a crossbow.
Yeah.
That's never had a rifle attached to it.
Yeah. I mean, you know.
Or, you know, I had to have an upper attached to it.
Yeah.
Well, see, here's the thing. That Wolf A1, I guess it's supposed to be the upper to a T91, which is a Taiwanese rifle, service rifle.
Yes.
Is the Taiwanese service rifle basically just an AR lower with this upper on it? Or is it?
I believe that that Wolf upper will pin right on to any AR lower.
Well, it'll pin on any AR lower. But what I'm trying to figure out is I wouldn't mind having a, quote, T91 as a representative gun in the armory, but I don't know what a T91 is really supposed to look like.
Does it just look like an AR with
this upper on it, or is it, does it have like a special, does a T91 lower look different than an AR lower? Other than like, you know, Republic of Korea markings on them or something. You know what I mean? or Republic of China marking, sorry. I got Korea on the mind. ROC, not ROK.
I guess I'm not understanding exactly what you're asking is a Korean T-91.
Taiwan, I'm sorry, Taiwanese T-91. I apologize. I've been saying the wrong goddamn name. Taiwanese T-91.
Yeah, basically it looks just like an AR.
Oh, okay. So, if we were to get, so we could basically build a T-91 clone and it wouldn't be that hard. It would, like, we wouldn't have to, like, machine the lower or do a bunch of shit.
No. I mean, if you bought the Wolf upper and threw it on a lower, basically you've got a T-91. Well, you don't have a T-91, but you know what I mean. It'd be a...
Oh, yeah, just take a piece of duct tape, write T-91, and stick it right to the lower there.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, you know, I mean, look, I'm...
When I first heard about them, I don't know, I think I sent you a link on it two, 3 weeks ago, and then you sent me a link like earlier this week on it.
Yeah, I never heard of them until you brought it to my attention, because I don't swim in those waters, and you kind of do. So I was like, what's this thing?
Yeah, I mean, you know, when I saw that, it's like, man, that's a pretty good price, you know, and...
And 2 pallets of them.
Yeah. At the end of the day, I mean, if you have any questions, I mean, you can call up there and talk to Eric, and I'm sure he'd be able to set you straight on what it will and will not do. I mean, they're nice. All the guys up at AIM they're really nice guys. They're easy to talk to. I mean, you know, they're busy. They're busy. But I mean, if they'll tell you. I mean, they're in business to sell their product. You know, if you have a lower and you want to buy this upper, and you know, if you have any questions, you know, and say, hey, you know, I have a Deltonics lower. Will this fit on it? They'll tell you, yeah or no. I mean, they're not going to sit there, yeah, it'll fit. You know, send it to them and it won't fit. No, if it won't fit, they'll tell you.
They're selling them for $599. And the upper comes with iron sights. Let's see here. Short stroke piston, hammer forged barrel, one piece bolt carrier, 1-7 twist, flash suppressor, proprietary rapid clean one piece piston system, authentic T-91 hand guard. Okay, that's furniture you need. Authentic T-91 charging handle. Okay, I guess that's furniture you need. All no rear sight included. They're showing it. You know, I mean, I could maybe be talked into this. I know you were interested. And these are being made in Taiwan, right? I mean, these are actual Taiwanese made guns.
Well, or you know, I don't know. They're being made by Wolf. Wolf is Soviet.
But
Wolf has a factory in Taiwan. That's why we're able to get Wolf ammo.
Wolf, for example, Wolf match ammo is actually made in Taiwan.
That's what Wolf I'm Gold. Saying. So I don't know if Wolf is making these in Taiwan or if these are Taiwanese made and Wolf is exporting them.
I think Wolf's the importer. I think Wolf's importing them into the U.S. I'm pretty sure these are, because I had looked into somewhere and I think these are, as a matter of fact, because there was even a story in like the Taiwanese media. Because, you know, again, like you're a little pissant country, anything positive that's said about your country, they want to know about it. So they're real proud that the American gun consumer wants their national gun. They like the regular media was talking about it. And so they're made by the same people that make whoever is their defense manufacturer for this rifle that makes the T-91 is making these uppers. It's not Wolf, or unless Wolf makes them for the government over there. I do know that.
Well, so. I can answer you. This is coming from the Taipei Times.
That's probably what I saw.
Okay.
Go ahead. We'll give it to the listeners.
It says, basically the Ministry of National Defense produced industry produced industry or technology, state that the ministry's technological products are separately categorized, blah, blah, blah. Yeah, basically what it is Wolf Industries, or Wolf Ammunition is basically importing them to the U.S. These are basically Taiwanese made by the whatever, I don't know what arms plant makes this stuff. You know, I don't know the name of the company, but basically they're basically the Taiwanese government makes these, and then Wolf Ammunition is importing them to the U.S.
It's interesting. Well, here's my debate. Which would you rather have first? Like, we only have so much money. We could spend, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars and buy all kinds of guns we want, but then, you know, everything else collapses. So, let me ask you this. Which would you rather have first? A T-91 clone or a new manufactured Delisle suppressed 45 ACP carbine?
Oh, the T-91 clone.
Really?
Yeah.
Before the fully suppressed Delisle carbine?
Oh, absolutely. Because the T-91 clone could be bought today. I mean, we could buy it right now and pick it up within a couple of hours, and we could be shooting it this afternoon.
You have no patience.
No, it's not that. It's the thing is, before I would spend the money on, you're talking about like the bolt action Delisle.
Yeah, apparently I call it Delisle, but apparently it's called a Delisle.
Well, whatever. Yeah. Yeah. You call it a fucking pig if you want. But the thing is, I think within the next year, suppressors are going to come off of NFA, and that's going to open the door to guns like this. Opposed to,
well, the Delisle is, it's two tax stamps. It's the suppressor and it's the short-barreled rifle.
Well, but still, if you only have to file one tax stamp on it, it's going to be a lot quicker process than two.
I think the issue with the Delisle is actually just getting the money to the people and then just getting in line so they can make it. It's not the tax stamp to me. And also, I didn't really care about I'm not going to want to just piss $200 away or $400, but you know, the bills as they're currently written, if they retroactively will refund, I guess, some of the money. If you're after a certain date, if you go through a tax stamp, at least for a suppressor.
I understand that.
But I just feel like, here's the thing, because like I get these arguments with these guys over 300 blackout, but you know, it all started again. I don't know why.
I'm so over 300 blackout.
You know, but for us, like a suppressed 45 ACP carbine is so practical. Dude, we could do so much with that gun.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a part of me is like, why the hell won't we just go ahead and just buy? The only reason we don't buy one, it's not that we can't afford it. It's the logic you give right now. Well, God, we got to wait. And we never buy that shit. And then we're like, why don't we have one? And part of me's been thinking maybe I should just go ahead and stroke them a check and just get it started. And then we could have one. Because, you know, we could do so much deprivation with that gun. And we could do so. I mean, think about all the we shoot a lot, and we shoot a lot of different places. But think of all the places we could shoot where you can't shoot now. We could shoot that gun, and we could run the shit out of that gun.
Oh yeah, oh yeah, no doubt. And I mean,
if you think about the Delisle for us, the Delisle is literally a 365 year hunting gun for us.
Yeah. Yeah, but here's the problem with it. Man, what are they, like $2,500?
Oh yeah, I mean yeah, it's yeah, yeah. I mean yeah, it's I mean it's that's why, you know, it's easy when I'm traveling and I run across a PPQ and 45 just to pick it up and have it shipped back to the armory, as opposed to, you know, waiting a year for a Delisle. You know, I end up spending more money in the long term on all these little guns we're not even shooting. We got so many guns in this armor we don't shoot.
I know.
It's just like, fuck. I know. Well, you know what? We can take this off the air. I mean, we don't need a bunch of dead air while we sit here debating how we're going to spend our money. Here's a story came out of air. It's a sad story. Being a professional hunter in Africa is a dangerous job. I mean, it's a dream job for a lot of people, but you need to know what you're doing. Because the only place worse than Africa where everything is trying to kill you is Australia.
Fuck Australia. God damn. Everything in Australia either bites, stings, or eats you.
Yeah, I mean, you know, well, I mean, I'm not trying to be more somber here. There was a PH, African PH feared eaten by crocodiles. South African professional hunter Scott Van Zyl, 44, so, I mean, you know, not an old guy, is believed to have been killed and eaten by crocodiles in Zimbabwe. Van Zyl vanished last week while hunting along the Limpopo River in Zimbabwe. If you read any of those, you know, Rhodesian war books, you've heard of the Limpopo River. A rescue team found his tracks and backpack near the river. According to the Telegraph, two large Nile crocodiles were spotted in the area and were shot and killed. Human remains were found in both reptiles.
I actually heard about that. Yes.
Yeah. I mean, you know, he stopped by the river to do something, and I mean, unless, you know, and he was, and it, the croc saw him, and they shoot out of the water, and they grabbed him right on the bank,
sucked him right in, and then, you know, they had a feast on him.
Yeah, I would hate to go that way. Crocodiles, I hate crocodiles. I hate them. I hate them.
Yeah.
I mean, crocodiles, alligators, to me, they're the same. I don't care. I mean, to me, kill them all.
As far
kill
as I'm concerned, they're the same. Yeah. You know, the only thing here's the crazy thing about this.
Oh, here we go. Situational awareness.
No. It's not situational awareness. It's just weird phobias.
Oh, for you?
Yeah, man. I mean, look, I hate spiders and I hate snakes.
I did not know that.
Oh, yeah, dude. I hate spiders with a passion.
I did not know that.
I was bit by a brown recluse years ago. Well,
that'll do it.
Yeah, I still carry the scar from that. I hate spiders. They just freak me out. And I know most of them are harmless, you know, but it's just a weird phobia. And I hate snakes. I mean, and I know most snakes are fine, but you know, I've spent so much time, you know, out in the bush and
I mean, you're dealing with Grizzly Adams.
I was down in Georgia, going through some cypress swamps years ago. And we're with a group of guys, you know, and we're wading through water about, it's swamps. So, you know, you're anywhere from dry land to, you know, chest deep water. And we're walking through there and we're about knee deep. And I had this, I guess it was a water moccasin, swim right between my freaking legs. And I'm just like, oh man, I freaking hate snakes. I was down in Kentucky, and there's a lot of rhododendron trees, bushes, whatever. And I'm on this, kind of like, climbing up this ridge, and I'm on a game trail, and I took my arm and I pushed back this rhododendron branch, and my hand touched a copperhead that was curled up on this branch chilling. And I'm just like, oh, fuck me. I just, I hate snakes. I've never been bitten by one, but I don't care what kind of a snake it is. As far as I know all the guys that like snakes get on this tirade about how they're, look, I just assume kill a snake than to look at it. And I don't give a shit what kind of snake it is. I hate them that much. And I'm sure that's probably going to piss off a few guys that listen to this, because the guys that like snakes always get ass hurt when you tell them you hate snakes. But I freaking hate snakes. Snakes and spiders, as far as I'm concerned, burn them all.
So that movie was what the hell is the movie where like we're at war with the space bugs? Or whatever it was, like the spiders.
I don't know, but let me tell you something. Arachnophobia freaked me the hell out. Dude, I hate them. I hate them. I mean, you know what? I mean, look, so I don't mind crocodiles and alligators.
So if some little hippie porn girl, Antifa girl is trying to drive you away at a protest, she doesn't need to throw M80s at you. She needs to throw snakes and you punch her in the face.
You'll see me running across the parking lot screaming like a girl with my arms in the air. Oh man, dude, I'll tell you what, I was out in Missouri. Oh, this is probably 20 years ago, every bit of it. And I was doing some creek fishing around the Ozarks. Mm-hmm. And I had a shotgun slung to my back, and it was my snake gun.
There's nothing wrong with that.
I racked up quite a few snakes on that trip.
So you were like the snake serial killer. You were out there just you'd see a snake, you know, it's 100 feet away from you, and you would still shoot it.
Oh, well, not 100 feet away. It was a shotgun, but we're creek fishing and these creeks, had quite a few snakes in it. And I whacked quite a few snakes. I hate them. Hate them. Not a fan.
Yeah, well,
now look, with that being said, I've got a lot of wooded property, on my land. And when I'm cutting grass, if I see a little garden snake running across the ground, I don't like go out of my way to run over it or anything, but not a fan.
That's part of the reason why I guess I'm more of a fan of areas that get really, really, really cold. Because a lot of people don't understand this. So like tornadoes to me aren't that big of a deal, but hurricanes,
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah,
people that live in the South, they're like, hurricanes are no big deal to them, but tornadoes freak the shit out of them. And that's a perfect example. See, like people in the South, bears, a lot of times bears freak them out. They're like, bears. Especially big bears, or us, whatever.
Yeah, whatever.
It's a fucking bear.
Well, I'll give you what you just said is exactly true. I was up in Boston several years ago talking to a guy who happens to be actually in the College Hockey Hall of Fame. But anyway, so I'm talking to this guy, and and he's like, oh, you're from Cincinnati, Midwest and all that stuff. And he's like, he's asking me about tornadoes. And I'm like, yeah, whatever. No big deal. And he's like, man, they just freak me out. The whole thought of a tornado. And I'm like, well, tell me about hurricanes, there they call them nor'easters or whatever. And he's just like, it's no big deal. And I'm like, well, the way you feel about those is exactly the way I feel about a tornado. I said, but frankly, going through a hurricane just freaks me out. I don't know about freak me out, but I've never been through one. But I've been through several tornadoes, and it's like, whatever. So, yeah, I mean, your analogy is exactly correct. I've had that conversation.
People fear what they don't know.
Yeah. I do know spiders, though, and I know snakes, and I still fear them.
Yeah.
You know, it's just a weird phobia. Some people are deathly afraid of clowns. I don't get it, but they are, you know. I mean, it is what it is.
Yeah. Yeah. I understand. I'm not, you know, or I mean, you know, I mean, people used to make fun of me on Facebook because I hate sharks. I don't like anything in the water that can eat me that's faster than me in the water, and that's why I don't like alligators and I don't like sharks. I mean, you know, I mean, it's like, I don't like that shit, you know. I mean, I was down near Beaufort and in the goddamn water, and a wave came in and rolled over me. I mean, I'm in pretty deep water, and a shark was in that wave looking at me. And I was
Look, sharks never bothered me. When all the time I was diving,
well, this is
and
probably
stuff.
Like a tiger shark. This is either a tiger or a bull shark. It was either a tiger or a big bull shark, and like they're both real aggressive, and it's just like, oh fuck.
Nah, I mean, you know, all the times, you know, I spent in the water diving, sharks never bothered me. But let me tell you something. What you need to worry about more than sharks are barracudas. Barracudas are dicks.
I was swimming with a barracuda last year, the year before.
Yeah,
it was hunting a fish, and I was watching it hunt the fish.
A barracuda will bite your hand off because it likes the glistening off of your ring if you're wearing, you know, jewelry, wedding rings, you know, or class rings or whatever.
I've heard that before.
Barracudas are assholes. I mean, look, a barracuda will go out of its way to mess with you, where a shark, you know, I'm not saying that sharks aren't dangerous.
Are barracudas smart or stupid? I get the impression that they're probably stupid, where sharks are pretty smart.
I mean, I don't know. I mean, hell, I don't know if they're smart or stupid. I know they're assholes, you know. Yeah, I mean, honestly, I don't know, but I know they will attack anything that's sparkly or shiny because they're basically just a feeding machine.
You're describing sharks and crocodiles too, so you know.
Well, yeah, but you know, I mean, the thing is, all the time I was diving, I worried more about barracudas than I did sharks. Mm,
you know what? If I was probably as intelligent on the subject as you are, I probably should have paid more attention to the barracuda. I mean, I watched it, but it was like, he's looking at that fish.
Yeah, well, you know, here's your worst nightmares if you're snorkeling or scuba diving nude and you got a Prince Albert, boy, you are in trouble.
Oh God.
No, yeah, but you know, no, sharks don't bother me too much. You know, I mean, I don't want to, like, you know, swim with the sharks like people swim with the dolphins, but you know, generally they don't really mess with
you. You know what? I don't really much care to swim with dolphins either. People are like, hey, you want to swim? I'm like, no, I don't need to get near goddamn dolphins. I've seen them regularly, and I'm like, yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
I have no desire to come up. I have no romanticization. I have no romantic images of dolphins from, like, you know, dolphin kick your ass.
Yeah, well, you know, dolphins kick sharks' ass.
Yeah, dolphins can be assholes. I mean, it's like, oh, yeah, they're so, you know, yeah, uh-huh, yeah, yeah, well, they can be ass. Dolphin, I don't, you know, again, this big-ass animal that can move like freaking lightning in the water, and it decides it doesn't like you. I don't like, whatever. I like the fish that are scared of fucking people. The fish are like, holy shit, a person. You know, fish that aren't afraid of me, I'm like, yeah, fuck you, motherfucker.
Yeah. Well, you know, the thing is, like, you know, snorkeling and diving and that's all fun. I mean, but, you know, you're out of your element, and there's a lot of predators in the water that basically will kick your ass.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't want to make it sound like, you know, it's well, I mean, you know, diving is dangerous because, you know, I mean, there are, you know, you're out of your elements, you know, I mean, you know, if your tanks run dry, you're dead, you know, I mean, there is an element of danger there, but I mean, there's a lot of critters in the water that will kick your ass. You know. So, but like, you know, anymore, I mean, hell, anymore, I haven't dove in years. Anymore, I just snorkel. Because honestly, I can snorkel in water, you know, 15, 20 feet deep. And truth is, past there's not a whole lot to see anyway. All the cool shit's within 10 feet.
Yeah, you know, I mean, you were like Jacques Cousteau, all that shit. So, you know, I don't. Hey, do you remember the University of Missouri? Remember, okay, we're like, you know, for the school near Ferguson that had all the issues, you know, that Black Lives Matter and, you know, they had all these protests and riots and, you know, they had the professor that, remember the girl, the professor they busted on film?
Basically, yeah. The crazy one. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, anymore now. I mean, dude, I mean, they got a transgender woman who won a women's weightlifting competition. We've gone beyond the crazy one, which, what the hell? That doesn't narrow it down.
No, actually, I guess it doesn't.
The University of Missouri, that school, and this is where this is where I like the market. And this is where the market needs to decide some things. The University of Missouri has closed several dorms on campus because their enrollment is way down.
You know, I think I heard, I saw a blurb about that.
You know, I mean, look, I don't know what the kids think, but if I was a parent and my child had to choose between a couple schools and that school was on the list and there were other choices and I'm paying the freight to be like, guess what? You're going to UCLA. You're not going to that fucking school. I mean, even though UCLA, at least, you know, I mean, you know what I mean? I mean, it'd be another, what typically people that would be in the running for University of Missouri where they would have other schools that maybe in that same caliber. Yeah. Be like, no.
Yeah.
No, not going to happen.
Yeah.
So, I thought you would find that funny.
Well, Did you hear about the
woman that raped the cabbie upstate?
No, I did not hear that.
They called this. I thought you'd heard about this because you work in the ghetto, so you would know why they think this. So a cab is called to this ghetto apartment complex.
Yeah.
And cab shows up, woman gets in, two guys get in, they pull weapons on the cab driver, take his money, and then the woman, they unzip the cab driver's pants, and the woman basically performs oral sex on the cab driver at gunpoint, and then they left. And you know, she took
a little DNA with her.
and here's she's been charged with rape, and here's the dude, you know this is what they were thinking. They're like, it's not robbery if we get him off. He's paying for a trick, or he won't call the police if we perform a sex act on it. You know what I mean? They had some bullshit logic in their mind as to how they were going to make this robbery work and get away with it.
Yeah, and that's what they're stupid.
Yeah, I mean, it's just like. You know, I mean, it's, you know, she was cute. I mean, she's on the downslope of cute because, I mean, she's obviously on the pipe.
Yeah.
You know, within 5 years, she's going to be a PSA.
Oh, yeah.
So that's really pretty much all I got today. You got anything else you want to cover?
I heard a blurb, and this is not confirmed, but the last – I don't remember even what city it was in, but it was a bunch of, you know, Antifa, anti-Trump rioters, you know, getting it with, you know, I think it might have been, you know, I think it might have been the tax day thing where there was a bunch of fighting. Well, anyway, apparently this masked Antifa person took a bike lock and whacked some dude in the head with it and pretty much clocked him out. A pro-Trump supporter got whacked in the head with this bike lock, Yeah, I don't know if it was like, you know, one of those like kryptonite type locks or whatever. But anyway, it turns out they were trying to find this guy because, you know, I mean, you know, it's assault with a deadly weapon type thing. You know, this is goes beyond throwing some firecrackers, you know.
How badly injured was the victim?
He was hospitalized. I don't know, you know, I mean, they took him to the hospital. I don't know if he was released or held or whatever. I don't know a lot of detail on it, but it's turning out that they think that the masked anti-Trump Antifa guy was one of the local college professors.
Of course he was.
So, life's not going to be looking too good for him.
Can they prove it was him?
I don't know. I haven't heard enough details yet to know if it's been verified or what it is. I'll try to get more information and follow up on it later, but we'll see how it goes. And of course, it all you heard about the anti-Trump Antifa people at Auburn University, did you not?
Dude, they're all I know the girl that got drilled by, I guess the guy that punched her is basically kind of a douchebag Nazi, and then the girl that got punched is basically kind of a douchebag porn star.
Yeah.
Is that Auburn? I thought that was Berkeley.
No, that was Berkeley, and I think that's the same place where the guy got clocked in the head with the bike lock. But
okay, all right. Well, I don't know what Auburn is then.
Okay, at Auburn University, and this was just a couple of days ago, all these you know, these anti-Trump Antifa people were going to the rally, and when they were going to the rally, they had all these cops lined up. Now they weren't stopping them from going to the rally, but all the helmets and the masks and the bandanas and the hoodies are like, take them off. You can go to the rally, but you got to uncover your face. So the cops were making them strip down all their disguises and shit.
There was actually, what's today's date? The 21st, about 2 weeks ago in Europe, in Sweden, because I mean, you know sports better than I do. I don't think you're a big sports watcher, but if you were to go to a soccer match in Europe, it would not be uncommon to basically it turns into a giant, like, you know, fist
riot.
Yeah. Well, it turns I mean, it's ridiculous.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Well,
yeah. Go to South America. Whoa.
Oh yeah. Holy shit. But, you know, and again, if you are listening to this and you ever run across somebody who wants to talk about how civilized Europeans are, I'm not talking like the stuff with the Muslims that's going on over there now. I'm talking just in general, just be like, yeah, really? Well, you know, we don't have people, we don't make it a national sport to try to kill each other in the stands at our NFL games. You know, I mean, it's like, it's unbelievable. So what happened was in Sweden, and you know, like the Russians and the Brits are the worst, but people were, you know, kicking each other's ass and doing whatever, so they started wearing masks, and you know, I mean, it's pretty, yeah, we're gonna pass a law, you can't wear a mask in public, you gotta take your mask off. You know, okay, fine. Well, this is Europe, dude. So what these are obviously guys. They're wearing guy like puffy jackets and jeans and gym shoes, and they're soccer fans, and they're going to this soccer match. So they all put on, they're calling it soccer hooligans in Sweden have donned Muslim niqabs to get around the newly imposed ban on masks. So basically they're not wearing the full dress. They're just wearing the head, the bag over your head part. And literally it's like, well, you can't take this mask off because religious freedom.
Yeah. That's actually working.
And there's pictures of them in the frickin' stands with these frickin', and it's just like, dude, tell me you don't love that. Tell me that isn't just, you know, this is awesome. I mean, just
wow.
Yeah.
Wow, that's crazy.
That is. I had seen that, and I forgot to tell you about that. And I was like, yeah, wait a minute. That'll come in handy one day. So, you know what? We're going to end this one on – I'm going to end this on two funny – they're not – one of them's not really that funny, but, you know, one of them is. Two notes, and we're going to wrap this one up because we're over an hour here, and we gotta wrap this one up.
Okay.
Here – the one of them is going to talk about the Middle East peace process, and the reason why – the quote Palestinians will never have their country, will never have an independent state, is because they don't deserve one, and because they haven't earned it, because their culture is not equivalent to everybody else's. And here's a perfect example: Israel, you know, being nice, being humanitarian, frequently, if somebody gets sick, you know, even if you're on the battle, like if you're a intifada person and you get injured, the Israelis will pick you up and bring you to a hospital and treat you. I mean, if you have cancer and you live in the, and you know, you're a Palestinian, they will, you know, okay, come on, we'll take care of you and we'll pay for it. Well, the Israelis are transporting somebody who has cancer into Israel for treatment, and they detected that Hamas was trying to sneak explosives through the checkpoints into Israel for a suicide attack in the cancer patient's transport.
Ah, that's interesting.
Mm-hmm. That'll never make the news here in the U.S. Whereas, like, all of our friends in Israel, like, yeah, that these people are fucking nuts, dude. I mean, that's why they built that big ass wall, you know. And you know, suicide attacks inside of Israel. I mean, there was, you know, they've done a couple of the drive, you know, where they, you know, they'll run people over, but the whole, like, people blowing themselves up inside of Israel, like in Sabaro and all that, has gone way down because Israel built the wall.
Yeah.
And the second thing
But hey, ask all the snowflakes here. Walls don't work.
Well, speaking of snowflakes, this is an example of the left people on the left just can't accept reality, even, you know, if it doesn't go in their favor. An Oregon man died peacefully in his home after his ex-wife lied to him and told him President Trump was impeached.
Yeah, I heard that.
Michael Garland Elliott, 75, passed away on April 6th, surrounded by friends, caregivers, and neighbors who loved him. Teresa Elliott, 68, Michael's ex-wife, who was described as his, quote, best friend in his obituary, told the Daily News that she told him Trump was impeached over the phone from her home in Austin, Texas. I knew in his very, very last moments, Teresa said, I knew that I would bring him comfort, and it did. He then took his final breath.
Yeah.
And it's just like,
yeah, I don't know what to say about that.
Yeah, you don't it's like that's really – it's kind of like – that isn't almost maybe the summation of all the left's arguments. I mean, like, you know, global warming is just – they don't like the facts, so let's just change the facts. You know, Hillary Clinton is a terrible candidate. I mean, look, objectively speaking, how the hell did Donald Trump win the presidency? I mean, if they had run somebody that wasn't goddamn crooked as fuck.
Yeah.
I mean, and a terrible
You know, if they would have run just about anyone other than a Clinton, they probably would have won.
You know, we'll never know, but you can certainly make the argument that she was the wrong person to run. And, you know, the problems with the Clintons, it's like Donald Trump being impeached. He hasn't been impeached. It's a fact. Everyone knows Hillary Clinton has all these terrible problems. And again, you know, it's just like, you know, well, now it's the Russians. Well, they didn't lose the election. It was the Russians. And they have to make up reasons so they can avoid dealing with reality. Well, the reality is the reason we're even having any of these conversations about, you know, hacking the election and Russians and the 702 program and the 215 program and, you know, Hillary's email and all this crap is because Hillary Clinton is a selfish fuck. And she decided that she was above the law and she wanted to have her own server in her own house so she could hide her communications from congressional oversight because reasons.
Well, actually,
and the Russians and the Chinese and the Israelis and the Germans and the Taiwanese and the Koreans and the North Koreans and everybody else got in that server.
Well, someone just wrote a book, a tell-all book about the Clinton campaign.
Oh, I heard a blurb about that.
Okay. Now, this person said that the main reason she had her own private server is when she lost in 2009, when she lost the nomination to Barack Obama, she immediately started looking at her own people, you know, who leaked this, who did this. You know, it wasn't her. Obviously, she was betrayed by an insider, and she got paranoid, and she, like, started, like, looking at all of their emails, and, you know, and she started digging in to find out who betrayed her, and then once she realized how easy it was for her to dig into all these emails, she decided, well, fuck, I don't want that to happen to me. So she started to do her own server thing.
You know what? I've never heard that, but that certainly makes sense.
I mean, yeah, I don't know if it's true or not. This is just an article I read on, you know, about this guy or this girl. I don't know if it's a guy or a girl. This person who wrote this tell-all book about Hillary's, you know, campaign and this last time around. So I don't know.
Well, they keep talking like she may run be the mayor of New York.
And I've heard that. I don't know.
I don't know what I think. They're so cravenly, power hungry that I just, you know, I don't question it. But I do know that Uma Abedin, and look, I will say this on a personal level, I like Uma Abedin. I mean, I don't dislike her, and I'm fully aware of who she is, and I'm fully aware of her connections to the Muslim Brotherhood and her parents. I know a lot about Uma Abedin, so don't people want to jump through the goddamn computer right now at me. I'm just saying on individual level, she is apparently shopping a book. She's shopping a, quote, tell-all book, or at least a story, a book describing her time, because she's worked for Hillary Clinton since, like, 96.
Yeah.
And she wants apparently she wants $2 million, and she's having a hard time getting it. If she actually writes the real book, if I was a publishing house, I would – if she's going to write the real book about what's really been going on with Hillary her whole life, that $2 million would be worth it. But I don't know if she's still working for Hillary or not, or whether – Hillary's still going to run for office or not. And, you know, is Uma Abedin out? Does she not work for Hillary anymore? You know, what's going on with Hillary? Like, really done?
Well, I mean, I don't know. I don't know if she's still working for Hillary or not. I mean, she was, correct me if I'm wrong, but wasn't she Hillary's chief of staff while she was Secretary of State? I'm pretty sure she was, like, Hillary's chief of staff.
I think that might have technically been what's the woman's name? I think the woman's a black woman. What's her name?
I don't know.
I can't remember the woman's name. I can see her face. There's State Department employee chief of staff, and then there's like body man. Body man is a real term, chief of staff. And, you know, basically Uma Abedin is the chief of staff of Hillary Clinton's life. So when Hillary Clinton left the State Department, Uma is with her. When Hillary, you know, goes to wherever Uma is one of the few people that actually would really talk to Hillary all the time. And there's a lot of infighting now that a lot of people that when they're not talking about the Russians, they're trying to blame Uma. Cause, you know, like, you know, Leon or, John Podesta and, they were some of the other people that worked in her campaign there's a guy that worked with Uma as an intern in the White House when Uma was an intern for Hillary, and Monica Lewinsky was an intern for Bill. There's a guy who was also an intern, and he was running a big pack that, you know, I mean, it's, if you knew how all these people in Washington, just how basically butt fucking they all are each other, it's a really small group. And right now, when the Russian story gets stale and everybody starts to really look in the mirror and blame whose fault is this, people are scrambling for the exits, trying to write the story, you know, as to, you know, whose fault that, you know, this election, you know, who lost this election? Did Hillary lose it because she sucks? Did Leon, John Podesta lose it because he's a fucking idiot with his email? Did Uma lose it because she never told Hillary the truth and didn't have the guts to tell her what was going on and kissed her ass? Or, you know, or was it the staff people that basically, you know, bought their own, you know, their own story, saying that we don't need to try to get middle America to support us because, quote, working class people automatically support Democrats, we don't have to work hard for their votes. Sounds a lot like the Democrats', you know, attitude for black people too, isn't it?
Yeah, kind of. Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, look, I don't know, 2-3 days ago, I was reading an article on President Trump's popularity polls. And the article's not important. And I don't they were talking about, you know, his ups and downs in the first 100 days of his presidency and all that stuff. And, you know, whatever. And the thing that came to my mind is, do I even believe this article? Do I even give any credence to these polls? Because when you look at the primaries and all through the election, oh, Donald Trump's down in this poll. He's down in this poll. He can't do this. He can't do that. And everything was proven wrong. All these polls were wrong. All the predictions were wrong. So why, what gives me, where do you try to convince me that your polls today are even right?
Yeah, I mean,
because we went through a year and a half of bullshit polls that were all lies and wrong. They were wrong. Oh, yeah. Donald Trump can't win this because the polls show him down 20 points. Boom, he wins it. Donald Trump can't do this because Hillary's beating him by 15 points. Oh, no, wrong. He won this. I mean, you know, every poll we've heard with Donald Trump for a year and a half has been proven to be wrong. So why do I – how do you convince me that his popularity polls that you're giving me today are correct and not bullshit?
Well, you can even see that in – and we got to wrap this one up because we're going way long. But, I mean, you know, the coverage of President Trump – I love saying that, by the way. The coverage of President Trump. I love that fucking guy.
Yeah,
when he shot the missiles into Syria, because all the left and all the media, they're all talking about, you know, we're going to go to war with the Russians and maybe a wag the dog and we're going to invade Syria and we're going to do this. And of course, you know, goddamn John McCain, you know, as soon as Donald Trump fires some missiles, John McCain crawls out of his hole like, oh, yeah, missiles. Yeah, missiles are good. Yeah. Yeah. It's the right thing to do.
And
they're all like, and, you know, they're all running these stories about, you know, all of a sudden now, Donald Trump's going to go into Syria. And, you know, I mean, Donald Trump is fighting ISIS. Donald Trump, there was zero chance. And we said this, and everybody inside the Beltway knows this. There is zero chance that Donald Trump is going to go to war with the Russians or go to try to depose Assad. You know, all he did was he fired some missiles and he sent a good message and he warned everybody, don't do this. And why did we fire missiles over these chemical weapons? We didn't do it for the Russians. We didn't do it for the Syrian people. We didn't do it for the rebels. We didn't do it for the victims. We fired those missiles for our interests. And again, the media doesn't report this, but this is everybody that actually knows how this works. This is the truth. We are the world's preeminent military superpower, period. The only way to fight us is to fight us asymmetrically. So and it's not hard to make chemical biological weapons. And our policy is, because it serves our interests, if you have chemical or biological weapons anywhere in the world, we're going to whack you. Because if we don't, these weapons are going to start sloshing around everywhere. And instead of it being an AK-47 on a Champs-Élysées, it's going to be a vial of VX or something. Because if you allow this shit to slosh around the world, eventually it's going to slosh on us. And we don't care about, I mean, again, this is the Machiavellian truth. We don't care about the kids that died because of the gas attack a few weeks ago in Syria. We care about chemical weapons being readily available around the world and it being acceptable. And, you know, we have a position that if you, I don't care who you are, I don't know if your name is Timothy McVeigh or Timothy McJihad, and you have a bucket of chemical weapons, expect a missile on your forehead, period. We don't give a fuck who you are. Yeah. That's in our interests. We're not going to take Assad out. We're not invading fucking Syria and turning it into Iraq. And everybody knows this, but the media, people in the U.S., if you watch the media and people commenting on our Facebook page, you know, this is a real president. Trump's dealing with the real, you know, whatever. And Trump's not so different after all. And, you know, we're going to do this and we're going to. No, we're not. We're not. You know, and that's a perfect example of the media just running a bullshit story for a few weeks. Everybody that knows how this works knows the truth. And then it goes away and everybody forgets about it. Just like the polls you mentioned, all these bullshit polls. And then they're not real. But then it goes away and nobody ever even – it's like everybody has the memory of about 3 weeks and then they just forget. You're right. You're absolutely right. I hate to use this phrase because it gets thrown around so much, especially on our Facebook page, fake news.
Yeah.
But so much reporting is done with an agenda. It's almost – I mean, it's just like, yeah, whatever.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. I got to get over to a taxidermist. So, all right. Well, this wraps up episode 60 of the John 1911 podcast. If you want to see pictures of the cocaine bust that we were laughing at, I'll see if I can't get them up onto the blog page, john1911.com. That's john1911.com. Our editing and promotional considerations for this podcast are Mitch at A&M Promotions. He basically makes us not sound like complete idiots. So remember, it's all about
thanks, Mitch.
It's all about shooting guns and having fun. And everybody have a good day.
See you later.